say a few quick things. It's been an honor to direct the cast. We have five people running the whole show back there. They're doing all the stage work and everything in between scenes, so that's been wonderful. The Oswego Players have been gracious enough to have us here for the fundraiser, and they've been wonderful as well, letting us be in their way a little bit here. And I'd also like to thank Dr. Nupuf and Stephen Wolf. They're the authors here. You know, without them authoring this play, we couldn't have been here at all, and it's lovely. After the show, we're going to have a talk back. We have a Oswego County historian here to share some things about Audrey after the production. And also, just so everybody knows, we were in the theater for only 10 days to put this thing together. So I'm really proud of how it all came out. It's been an honor. Thank you for coming, and enjoy the show.
Now, Mr. Barnes, we here at St. Lawrence Hospital for the Insane believe in proper attire at all times. Proper attire and rigorous decorum are essential to promote structured and safe environment for patient care. Now remember, breakfast will be at 8 a.m. sharp, lunch is served at 12 o'clock noon, and supper at 5:30 p.m. every day. There is no deviation for any reason. Although we do allow the patients to sleep an extra 30 minutes on Christmas and Easter. Is that clear?
Oh, yes, Mrs. Whiteside, very clear.
We also allow visitation on Saturdays from 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. Patients can see their visitors in the day room, but only if a doctor has reviewed their condition and they are deemed stable. Is that clear, Mr. Barnes?
Oh, yes, ma'am.
Never leave a patient unattended. These patients can be a danger to themselves or others if left alone. We here at St. Lawrence Hospital pride ourselves on our unblemished record of safety, and I will not have you tarnishing that record. Do I make myself clear, Mr. Barnes?
Oh, yes, Mrs. Whiteside, very clear indeed. I do have one question. Do the patients ever get to leave the hospital? I mean, do they ever get better and get to go back home again?
Rarely, Mr. Barnes. Well, some patients will enter St. Lawrence with a severe case of melancholy, and with time, proper rest, and treatment, their melancholy will lift and they are able to return to their previous environments. Most patients, however, have much more serious mental conditions that are not treatable and have no hope of recovery. That is why those patients are sent to us, to help them maintain a sense of dignity and structure in their lives. That is the role we play. That is our calling. Oh, here's Dr. Thompson now. Dr. Thompson, this is the new orderly, Mr. James Barnes. We have completed the orientation, and he will be working the 5 a.m. to 7 p.m. shift.
Very good, Nurse Whiteside. Nice to meet you, young man.
Oh, nice to meet you, Doctor.
I hope you'll find your employment here at St. Lawrence Hospital to be worthwhile. Nurse Whiteside, I need to talk with you about the upcoming health department inspection later this week. We need to make sure that the medical records are up to date and that each patient's progress note has been verified and stamped. Would you have time to come with me now to review the newest patient's records, please?
Yes, Doctor.
Are they gone?
Who?
That doctor and nurse. Well, they think I can't hear them, but I do. Well, say, you're new here, aren't you? What's your name, boy?
Jimmy. Oh, James Barnes, ma'am.
Well, Jimmy James Barnes. It's very nice to meet you. I'm Audrey. Audrey Munson. Oh, but you can call me Audrey.
Nice to meet you, ma'am.
Oh, are you from around here?
Oh, yes, ma'am. am. My folks are from here. This is where I grew up. But I live in Messina now. Is there something I can help you with?
Well, you can make sure that my legs are covered and straighten Mr. Bayer. Oh, thank you. Say, do you suppose you could get me some milk from the kitchen?
Oh, I'd be more than happy to. Are you thirsty?
No, but do you notice anything unusual about my face?
Well, ma'am, you do have very nice skin.
Well, Jimmy James, but may I just call you Jimmy?
Oh, yes, ma'am, please do.
Well, Jimmy, you seem like a very bright boy. Do you know why my skin is so nice? Well, it's because I wash my face 3 times a day with milk. Why, if everyone just washed their face with well, no one wants to hear from an old lady. Jimmy, do you know how old I am?
Oh, no, ma'am, I don't.
Well, that makes 2 of us. I just know that I'm old. And I've been here a very long time. Oh, I don't know why they don't just throw me out into the snow. Oh, who's paying for me to live here anyway?
Well, I don't know for sure, Miss Audrey. Perhaps one of your relatives are paying.
Don't have any relatives. Well, none that I know of, anyway. Probably all dead. When you've lived as long as I have, why, your kinfolk are either dead or moved away.
Yes, ma'am.
You're very polite, young man. Oh, I like that in a boy. Oh, your parents must have raised you right.
I don't remember my parents. They were killed in a car accident when I was 6. I was raised by my aunt.
Oh, why, I'm so sorry. Well, maybe you could bring her for a visit to say hello.
She moved to Florida and lives in Orlando.
I guess you and I will have to get acquainted then. Though I don't know why you would want to hang around with all of us old folks anyway. Oh, it seems kind of depressing if you ask me.
Oh, no, Miss Audrey. I think older people have a lot to share and are interesting.
Interesting? What do you think I would have to say that might be interesting?
Well, you've probably lived a long life and have seen and done a lot. Well, I've never been anywhere except to Plattsburgh and once to Albany. Have you ever traveled much? Like to New York City, for instance?
Well, Jimmy, would you believe me if I told you that I was once one of the most famous people in all the world?
Really? Oh, I knew it. Oh, were you a famous actress or singer?
No, I was a model. Well, my statues are all over the country, and I was in motion pictures. What do you think about that?
Oh, Miss Audrey, I'd be honored if you could tell me more about yourself.
Oh, well, all right then. Yes, well, I was born in Rochester, New York, you see. Oh, but I lived in a little town called Newhaven. Oh, it was the most lovely town. Not too big, not too small. And everybody knew everyone. Well, it was just Mama and me. You see, my Papa left when I was 6 or 7 to move to Syracuse. And while I did see him occasionally, well, mostly it was just Mama and me. Oh, but when I was 9 or 10, oh, Mama took me to the state fair. Oh, have you ever been to the state fair, Jimmy?
No, I haven't.
Oh, it was the most exciting day of my life.
Oh, Audrey, come back here. Audrey, don't go too far.
Mama, just look. There's a giant little seat and all sorts of games. Mama, can we go on room to ride? Mama, can I get ice cream? Oh, Mama, look.
What a lovely child, with hair like silk
like me to tell your fortune, child?
You can't really tell the future, can you?
Certainly I can. Why, I foretold the actions of kings and queens. I predicted floods and famines, wars and treaties. It would be my honor to foretell your future for the small price of 5 cents.
Mama, can I have my fortune told? Please, Mama, please?
Audrey, this man is a fake. No one can tell the future.
Ah, ye of such little faith. You believe in me, don't you, child? Now, let me see your hand. Perhaps the other one. This one's a little sticky. Ah, I see you have a long lifeline. This means you will live a long life. Now, this line is connected to your heart. You see how it branches and twists and turns. You will be loved by many people, but never by one. And this line is connected to your soul. You'll be both famous and infamous. But be careful what you wish for. Fame can bring happiness and sorrow, joy and pain. Now go and seek your future. That'll be 5 cents.
Well, I don't know if Mama took what that gypsy said as some kind of sign, or what I knew right away what I wanted, to be famous, rich and famous. Oh, and becoming rich and famous seemed rather unlikely in New Haven. Why, Mama packed our bags, and 1 year later, we boarded a train in Syracuse to New York City. Oh, it was the most lovely ride along the Hudson River. I danced up and down the aisles while I could hardly sit still. And then, when we finally landed in Grand Central Station and walked along the street, the people, they were pushing and shoving and always in a hurry. Oh, I heard the screeching of the streetcars and the clip-clapping of the horse-drawn wagons. Oh, and the most wonderful smells were everywhere. Why, I knew that was just where I wanted to be. Oh, but we had very little money and no friends or relatives. Oh, Mama took in a bit of sewing and washing, and I danced on the corner for pennies. Oh, at night, we'd go up on the roof of the apartment building and we'd look at the stars. And one night, I saw a shooting star and I wished that I could become a famous dancer. Oh, and then one day,
Fräulein. My name is Conti. Isidore Conti.
Hello, Mr. Conti. My name is Audrey Munson.
I've been watching you dance, and you are wonderful. The way you control your movements and interpret the music, it is fantastic.
Well, I thank you for noticing. I've worked hard to become a dancer, but there are so many girls who are much better.
been commissioned to create a magnificent sculpture for the grand ballroom of the Hotel Astor. And to create such a magnificent sculpture, I need a magnificent model. That is why I'm here to see you.
But I don't know anything about modeling. I'm a dancer, and I'm not very good at standing still.
Oh, I can see you have strong, well-shaped legs and torso. I can teach you what you need to know. I think you are the perfect model for my creation, the Three Graces.
Mr. Conti, I'd like to help you, but I'm already in a show, and I need the $18 per week that they're paying me. Perhaps one of the other girls can model for you. Good luck.
I will pay you $50 a week, Fräulein.
What did you say?
I will pay you $50 a week.
$50 per week? Why, for $50 a week, I'll jump in the Hudson River and swim to New Jersey. Okay, where do I go?
The address is 35 East 1st Street, 4th floor. Come tomorrow between 5 and 6 o'clock. The light should still be sufficient then. Auf Wiedersehen, Fräulein. Auf Wiedersehen.
Goodbye. See you tomorrow.
Audrey, who is that man?
He said his name was Mr. Conti. He liked to watch me dance. Mama, do you think we can stop on the way home and get something to eat? I'm starving.
Audrey, you are always hungry, but you need to watch your weight. All right, we'll pick up some food on the way.
Well, the next day, I went to his studio on East 1st Street, not knowing what to expect. Well, as I climbed the four flights of stairs, oh, I heard violin playing and smelled garlic cooking. Oh, and children were laughing and playing in the stairway. Oh, when I got to the fourth floor, I saw his name on one of the doors, I. Conti. So I knocked and waited, oh, but no one came. Well, so I knocked louder and I yelled, "Oh, Mr. Conti!" But still no one came. So I opened the door and I walked in slowly.
Mr. Conti, it's me, Audrey. Remember, you told me to come to your studio today. Hello? Is anybody here? Maybe this was not such a good idea. They find unsuspecting models dead in New York City apartments every day. How could I explain that to Mama?
Oh, Fräulein Munson, how nice to see you. Please, come closer to the window. I want to see your face in the fading light. Oh, it is perfect. See how the light accentuates the angle of your nose and the fullness of your lips. This is the perfect time to start, for we must begin immediately. No, Fräulein, not like that. I must see you in the altogether.
The altogether?
Yes, of course, the altogether.
Oh, I see. You mean there'll be other models and you want us to work all together. How silly of me. I'll just wait over here till they come.
Fräulein Munson, when I create a sculpture, I must see the soul of the model to incorporate that soul in the marble. The marble is a cold, lifeless object. It is only when the artist and the model can breathe life in the stone that it comes alive. I cannot see your soul through these clothes you wear. I must see your body as nature intended.
You mean you want me to take my clothes off?
Yes, that is exactly what I mean. I must see every curve, every shadow. To me, this is the essence of the human spirit, both physical and emotional.
Okay. You must be some kind of pervert, right? I am not that kind of girl. I can assure you. Goodbye, and good riddance.
I will pay you $75 a week, Fräulein. You must stay. I assure you, I am only interested in creating the perfect work of art. You have nothing to fear from me.
my clothes off and have you look at me?
Lord knows, we could use the extra money. But how do I know I can trust you?
Fräulein Munson, please. I'm an old man. You have nothing to fear. Now, come behind the curtain and take your clothes off. Come out when you are ready. You can. You may take it home with you. Now, let's get started while we still have the evening light. We don't have much time.
Weren't you frightened?
Oh, terrified, but at the same time, excited. Well, I was barely 18 years old, and I had never even worn a bathing suit in public before. Why, I couldn't believe what I was doing. Until I looked in Mr. Conti's eyes. Well, they were intense, sure, but also soft and reassuring, like what I was doing was completely natural. After a while, I forgot that I was naked and just concentrated on the poses. For the first time in my life, well, I felt special. And I liked that feeling. But if you think modeling is easy, why, well, you should try it sometime. Standing on your toes with your arms above your head, well, not moving, why, sometimes for an hour or more. Why, we worked in his studio when it was 100 degrees and sweat was pouring down my body. Other times, it was freezing and frost was in the windows. Oh, my muscles ached so, but I refused to change my pose. And Mr. Conti was patient and kind. He would say, Fräulein Munson, that is good, ja. Oh, but if you think modeling was difficult, that was nothing compared to going home and telling my mama what I was doing.
Mr. Barnes, whatever do you think you are doing?
Mrs. Whiteside, I was just talking to Miss Audrey, Miss Munson. She was telling me all about her life in New York City. Did you know that she was a famous model and that there are statues of her all around the city?
Yes, we are all aware of Miss Munson's past. But we here at St. Lawrence Hospital have tried to protect her from prying eyes and reporters that want to dig up the past. And we hope that you will respect her privacy as well. Now, please take Miss Munson to the dining room for her lunch and then report to the nurse's station to learn to pass medications.
Yes, Mrs. Whiteside.
Well, you better take me to the dining room, Jimmy. I don't want to get you into any trouble. Well, we can talk more later. Well, I have many things still to tell you. Oh, that is if you're still interested.
Yes, indeed, Miss Audrey. I'd love to learn more about your past.
Mama, I'm home. Sorry I'm late. Come see what I've brought you.
Audrey, where have you been? I've been worrying sick about you. Did you have to stay late at rehearsal again?
Look, Mama, I got bread and salami.
Conti's creating a sculpture, and I'm his model. What did you think I was talking about?
Nothing, my love. I understand.
You're his model.
Yes, Mama. But don't be upset. I take my clothes off.
But it's the only way for me to breathe life into his work.
All of your clothes?
Yes, Mama. All of my clothes.
And that's all you do? A model in your birthday suit? Don't you get a little cold?
Mama, try on the dress. I want to see how you look.
Okay, let's go to the bedroom. I'll try on.
You know, the food's not so bad here.
If it weren't for all that crying and carrying on, well, this might not be a bad place to live. Now, what were we talking about?
Well, you told your mother that you were modeling in the nude, and she seemed to think it was all right.
Well, I wouldn't say she was exactly pleased with my new career, but considering what she thought I was doing, why, I guess she thought modeling was okay, even with my clothes off. Oh, I sometimes worked 8 and 10 hour days. Oh, and for several different artists. Oh, I am beauty in the portico outside the New York Library. I posed for the Strauss Memorial, dipping my toes in the water in remembrance of those two dear people who died on the Titanic. Did you know Mrs. Strauss was offered a seat in the lifeboat, but she refused to leave her husband? Now, isn't that true love? Oh, I am the heroic woman at the entrance to the Manhattan Bridge. And I stand 40 stories above the city, the tallest statue in all Manhattan, a civic fame. I am both women on the fireman's memorial, one holding a fireman's helmet in my lap, with a child by my side and fear in my heart. The other, cradling the dead body of my beloved fallen fireman. And I am Pomona, goddess of abundance, holding a basket of fruit in front of the Plaza Hotel. Oh, I was making more money than I ever imagined. Well, Mama and I got a nicer apartment on West 65th Street. Oh, my statues were in front of buildings all over the city, and I was known as Miss Manhattan. That was a long time ago. I loved every minute of it. It was the most wonderful time in my life. And I met the most interesting people. Why, this one time, oh, I went to meet this artist about some possible work and...
Now, Henry, I am going to the Presbyterian Church to meet the new pastor. I will be back shortly. If the decorator I hired comes while I'm away, please show her the couch and chair that need recovering and get a price for doing them both. I won't be gone long. Goodbye, dear.
Goodbye, dear. I understand. Couch and chair. See you when you return. So little time, so much to do. May I help you?
Yes, I was told you may have some work for me.
Oh, indeed. My wife said you'd be coming. Please come in. We'd like you to do the couch and chair and give me a figure to do them all together.
You want me to do the couch and the chair all together?
Yes.
I understand. When would you like me to begin?
Just as soon as possible, young lady. Time is of the essence. I'd like you to begin today if you were able.
All right. I think I can do it today. And you're sure you want me to do them all together?
Yes, yes, all together.
Okay. Show me where I can change, and I'll be right back.
Archbishop Duke of Austria shot by Serb. That's not going to make Mrs. Archduke very happy, is it? Well, let's see what else. Boston Red Sox signed pitcher George Herman Ruth to a year contract. $10,000. What's happened to these baseball salaries anyway?
I'm ready when you are. Shall we begin with the couch or the chair?
Well, I suppose you might as well begin with this chair since I have work to do. Do you always take your clothes off, young lady, to do work?
Not always. It's up to the artist. Shall we begin?
Yes, by all means. And whenever you're ready.
Henry, I have forgotten my umbrella, and it looks like it might be... What is going on here?
You were right, dear. The weather can be so changeable, it's better be prepared.
Who is that woman?
What woman, dear? this woman. I never did get her name. You see, the decorator you hired came shortly after you went out, and I told them about the couch and chair like you told me, and she said she could begin today. Well, it appears she likes to work without her clothes on. Maybe she doesn't get her clothes wrinkled, dear.
Henry, how could you? After we've spent 30 years together. What is your name, you little homewrecker?
Audrey, ma'am. Audrey Munson. Your father, or your husband, told me that he wanted me to do the couch and the chair. I didn't mean to cause any sort of...
Munson. Munson? You're not Miss Munson, the famous model whose statues we see all over the city. Henry, this is one of the most famous people in all of New York. It is such an honor to have you in our apartment. Could I get you a cup of tea? Miss Munson, when did you become a decorator, dear?
Miss Audrey, you're pulling my leg, aren't you? That never really happened now, did it?
Indeed it did, young man. Indeed it did. Oh, we had a good laugh about it after I put my dress back on. Oh, turns out Mr. and Mrs. Penfield were wonderful people. Mrs. Penfield was very involved in the women's suffrage movement in Manhattan, and Mr. Penfield, why, he was quite the artist. I worked for him several times after that. Oh, but after the first encounter, only with my clothes on. I feel it's time for my afternoon nap. I think everyone should have an afternoon nap. Well, Jimmy, if you'd bring me to my room, I'll tell you all about the time Mama and I took the train to San Francisco for the 1915 exhibition.
Hello, and welcome to the Panama Pacific International Exposition. My name is Elizabeth Gaines, founder and president of the National Christian League for the Promotion of Purity. I have come here to review the ethical standards by which this exposition adheres to the principles espoused by our great organization. It is bad enough that this event is being held in San Francisco, which is the epitome of the Barbary Coast, with its drunkenness, saloons, and debauchery. is not against progress and sciences in general. Why, the working model of the newly constructed Panama Canal with all of its locks and miniature trains is quite impressive. And I enjoyed seeing the four vehicles being assembled and rolling away in only 15 minutes. But what I do have an issue with is how can our children attend such an event as this?
Miss Gaines! Jill Klein from the San Francisco Chronicle. Do you mind if I ask you a few questions?
Not at all. Not at all, young man. I would be happy to provide my views on whole host of subjects.
Hmm. All right, Miss Gaines, what does your organization, the NCLPP, think of the exposition?
Well, I must admit I have mixed reviews. On the one hand, I find that most exhibits are of decent and moral standing. But one only needs to look around to see the multitude of indecent statues and paintings. Oh, wait. See here? This, right here. This woman ought to be ashamed of herself. Posing without a single fiber of clothing for all the world to view. Oh, well, perhaps she has perfection of physical appearance, as these artists so play, but that does not give her license to parade her charms to the general public. It is a foolish notion that these artists must make a naked creature.
No! Miss Munson! Miss Munson! Jill Klein from the Chronicle. Now that you've been named Miss Exposition, what can you ascribe to your popularity as the world's most perfect model?
Well, Mr. Klein, the answer is quite simple. If a model wants to keep the place she has won, she must be businesslike and study. Study the artist who is composing the work. Study the subject that the artist has created. Take, for example, the Fireman's Memorial in New York City. Why, before I posed for that statue, I spoke with widows who had lost their husbands. I wanted to feel what they felt, losing a loved one in the line of duty. It is not enough to merely be able to hold a stated pose for a certain length of time, although you should try it sometime to see what it's like. I'd be happy to find some employment for you.
Oh, no, not me, Miss Munson. I have trouble bending over to tie my shoes. What's in store for you now? Will you continue with your modeling?
Oh, no. I just finished my first encounter with a silver screen called Inspiration, and I'm currently working on my second film called Purity.
Oh, what are the films about?
Well, in Inspiration, I play a young model who is discovered by a wealthy artist. The artist believes in the model, and he encourages her to pose for him. As the cameras are rolling, my nude body is covered in a full-body plaster mold. As the plaster dried, I felt as though I was going to suffocate. I could barely take even the shortest breath as the plaster became tighter and tighter. I now know what it must feel like to be buried alive. I'll never do that again. In Purity, I insisted I be allowed to pose in a lovely garden with trees and flowers and a trickling stream. I feel so free and alive in front of the camera that I am saddened when the day has come to an end. I find that I am only happy when it's time to begin filming again.
There you are, Miss Munson. Is there anything else I can get for you?
Oh, no, thank you, Doctor. Oh, it was so very kind of you to bring me back to the day room. Oh, have you seen that new orderly? I believe his name is Jimmy. Oh, he is such a nice boy. Oh, he and I were having the best talk. He thinks I'm interesting.
Oh, interesting. How nice. I saw Mr. Barnes in the medication room. He should be coming to the day room shortly. Oh, here he is now. I will leave you two to your discussions.
Oh, thank you, Doctor.
It is remarkable how refreshed one feels after a short afternoon nap. Is it time for supper? I'm starving. a drunken sailor. Jimmy, have you seen my mama?
No, I'm sorry, Miss Audrey, but I haven't seen her.
Oh, I just don't know where she could be. Well, she said she'd be right back to take me home. Oh, you'd like mama. Oh, she is as kind and considerate as they come. Oh, I wonder what's delayed her. Well, where were we?
Well, you were talking about your time in the pictures.
Yes. I was a star, wasn't I? Oh, people flocked to see me on the screen, and oh, my movies made millions. And the men? They all wanted to take me to parties and dinner. Oh, but I was far too busy. See? Not that I didn't have my share of suitors.
Were you ever married, Miss Audrey? Oh,
married? No. Oh, but I was engaged to be married. Oh, what was his name? Hans or Herman? Why, I can't remember. Oh, what I do remember is his family being very wealthy. Oh, see, they had a house, yes, yeah, in a summer house in Newport. Oh, I remember the parties and the dancing and walking on the beach at night. Oh, and we raced his boat on the ocean. Oh, with the wind and the surf in our faces. Oh, and he asked me to marry him. Imagine me. Poor girl from New Haven marrying a handsome, wealthy man from Manhattan. we were to be married that summer. And I was so happy. But then, well.
Miss Audrey, are you all right?
That's when everything changed. Well, my life was suddenly cursed. Cursed! Well, he broke off the engagement and wouldn't see me. And my friends wouldn't speak to me. And no one would hire me. Why, Mama and I had to leave and go to Canada to escape the whispers and the gossip. And it was all because of him!
Who, Miss Audrey? Who did this to you?
It was Dr. Wilkins. We had stayed in his boarding house in Manhattan, you see, and
good morning, Miss Munson. Not a bad day weather-wise for a February, wouldn't you say?
Good morning, Dr. Wilkins. Yes, it is indeed a beautiful day.
Did you and your mother enjoy the weekend on our home in Long Beach? I certainly had a wonderful time.
Oh, yes, Dr. Wilkins. I loved walking along the beach and watching the waves crash on the shore. Thank you so much again for inviting us to stay with you. You and Mrs. Wilkins are very gracious.
Oh, please, call me Walter. We can become the best of friends. Do you mind if I call you Audrey?
Do you think Mrs. Wilkins would mind?
Of course not. Just last week, Julia said how fond she is of you, and wouldn't it be nice if we could see more of you? I know I would like that. I would like to see a lot more of you. In fact, I've seen each of your movies several times, and I can't decide which movie I like more, Inspiration or Purity. I've started thinking about you a great deal lately. Audrey, if something were to happen to Mrs. Wilkins, I would be quite lonely and would value a friend like you to comfort me. We could become the best of friends and I could provide for you and your mother.
But, Dr. Wilkins, you don't have to worry about Mrs. Wilkins. Why, just the other day she told Mama how good she felt.
Yes, that probably is true. Well, one never knows what the future brings. There's always accidents and misfortunes that we can't control. Perhaps you'd like to join me for dinner next week.
Julia's going to be away visiting her sister in Newark, and I thought we could spend a little time together.
That's very kind of you, Doctor. I'll talk to Mama and see what day's good for her.
No! Not your mother. I was hoping it would just be the two of us. You see, Audrey, I'd really like to spend some time alone with you.
Dr. Wilkins! I'm sure Mrs. Wilkins would be very upset if she knew what you were asking me. Now I'll pretend that I never heard what you said. Good day, Doctor.
When I told Mama what the doctor said, well, she packed our bags, and we left New York the very next day. And a month later, well, that's when we read...
Extra! Extra! Read all about it! Doctor found guilty of murdering wife! Sentenced to die in the electric chair! Extra! Extra! Read all about it! Doc kills wife! Search underway for Audrey Munson!
Mama and I had done nothing wrong. Oh, but the papers made it seem like I was to blame. My life was like a sandcastle, slowly crumbling, falling apart. No work, no friends, no money. Jimmy? Jimmy? Jimmy, where are you? Oh, Jimmy! Jimmy, don't leave me! Oh, please don't leave me!
Whatever is the matter? It's all right. Calm down. You're okay. Mr. Barnes, I have told you never to leave a patient alone.
I'm so sorry, Mrs. Whiteside, that I had to...
I don't care what you had to do. You never leave a patient alone.
Yes, Mrs. Whiteside, I'm so sorry.
Okay. We'll overlook this one episode, but please don't let it happen again.
Yes, Mrs. Whiteside, and thank you.
Did I do something wrong?
No, Miss Audrey. It was my fault, not yours.
Is it time for supper? Well, I'm starving. Well, Mom always said I could eat like a drunken sailor. Well, have you met my mama, Jimmy? Well, she said she'd be here to get me. I don't know what's keeping her. Oh, well.
Well, Miss Audrey, we don't need to continue if it's too difficult for you.
No. I want to continue. I want to tell you all about it and why they put me in this place. Oh, you see, I'm not crazy. I'm not.
Well, you were telling me about Mrs. Wilkins and why you and your mother left New York City.
Yes, that. It was terrible. Why, poor Mrs. Wilkins. She was so kind to us, Jimmy. Well, if you'll bring me to dinner, I'll tell you about returning home to New Haven. We had no money and no place to live.
Bird out of its nest.
No, Mama. Honest, I found it on the ground. It can't fly, but I can take care of it. I will, Mama.
Audrey, you take that baby bird and put it right back where you found it. Its mother is probably worried sick and looking for it.
No, I won't. I found it, and I'm going to keep it.
Oh, Audrey.
Oh, all right. Away, Mom.
never wear high heels, and avoid all makeup. Yes, I'll tell them that they should discard their clothes and practice walking in front of a mirror, so that when they put their clothes back on again, they'll remember their graceful flesh under their gown.
Audrey, those days are past and gone. No one wants to hear what you think or say anymore, and they're certainly not going to pay for it.
They will so. I'm Audrey Munson, Miss Manhattan. My statues are all over New York City. People loved me. People still love me. What about that man? The one from Michigan who flies airplanes? He's coming next month to marry me. You'll see, Mama. He will marry me. And then we'll have lots of money. And we'll travel and go to parties.
Audrey? Audrey, I need to go into town and deliver the tablecloths and get more material. Okay? I'll be back shortly. You be good. And please do not yell at the neighbors again while I'm gone.
Well, then tell the neighbors to stop staring at me. They're German, you know. I think they're spies. There are a lot of German spies around. I think maybe I'll write the president. And I'll tell him that I'll work as a secret agent. And I'll report to him about those German spies. The president will probably give me a medal for helping.
Goodbye, Audrey.
Goodbye, Mama. Mama, I'll be okay while you're gone. What was that noise? Go away! I know you're out there! Leave me alone! I'll be okay. Mom will be home shortly. I'm back. What are you doing sleeping in the middle of the day? Wake up, sleepyhead. We need to fix dinner. Audrey? Audrey, are you sick? Are you waking up?
Thompson, may I ask you a question?
By all means, Mr. Barnes, ask away.
Well, it's about Miss Munson. Were you here at St. Lawrence Hospital when Miss Munson was admitted?
Mr. Barnes, how old do you think I am?
I don't know.
I've worked at St. Lawrence Hospital for 35 years, but Miss Munson was admitted in 1931. That's almost 60 years ago. As I recall, she was committed by a judge who was concerned about Audrey harming herself or others, and she's been here ever since.
Does she have any friends or relatives that come to visit her?
Sadly, not for many years. Her father and mother passed away years ago, and I'm not sure she has any relatives who even know she's still alive. Oh, there's the occasional reporter who wants to dig up the past for some sordid story, but we try to protect her privacy as much as possible.
Dr. Thompson, why do you think that her mother never wanted to take Miss Munson home?
Well, her mother was up in age when Audrey was committed, and frankly, I don't think she thought she could care for her. After a while, Audrey just thought of the hospital staff as her family. Did you know that next week is Audrey's 100th birthday?
That's amazing! Imagine living to be 100 years old! Dr. Thompson, what can help a person to live for so long?
Well, a good diet and exercise. And perhaps the good Lord isn't ready for someone who posed nude to enter heaven quite yet. Now, isn't there somewhere you need to be, young man?
Oh, yes, Doctor. I'm going right now.
Oh, you're new here, aren't you? What's your name, son?
It's Jimmy Barnes, Miss Munson.
You know my name?
Oh, yes, ma'am. You told me all about yourself.
Well, you look familiar. Oh, yes. Oh, you're that young man who lost his parents when he was little. Oh, now I remember. Oh, my memory just isn't what it used to be, I guess. Is it supper time? I'm starving. Mama says I could eat like a drunken soldier. Have you seen my mama? She said she was coming right back to take me home, but I guess that's not going to happen now, is it? Well, it's okay. Well, the food is okay, and they treat me like family here.
Hello, Miss Munson.
What's this all about?
Today is your birthday. You are 100 years old today.
What? Oh, you have to be joking. How does someone live to be? How old did you say?
100 years old.
Oh, my. Oh, it's too bad Mama couldn't be here for the celebration. Oh, Mama just loves a good birthday party.
Oh, I have a surprise for you, Miss Munson.
Oh, what is it? I love surprises. Oh, is it chocolate or a new Mr. Bayer?
Hello, Aunt Audrey. My name is Darlene. Darlene Munson Bradley. And this is my daughter, Emily.
Do I know you?
Well, no, we've never met, but I'm your niece, and this is your grandniece.
Go away! Well, I don't have any relatives!
Aunt Audrey, your father, Edgar, he remarried, and the youngest of his new children was your father, Harold. This nice young man contacted us and told us that you were living here in St. Lawrence, and he told us it was your birthday, and could we just stay a little while?
Is that your bear, young lady?
No, I brought it for you.
For me? Oh, isn't that nice? Oh, now Mr. Bear will have a friend. Come closer, child. Oh, I won't bite. Oh, what did you say your name was again?
Emily.
Oh, Emily. Well, Emily, what do you like to do?
I like to dance.
Oh! someday in New York City. Would you like that?
Yes.
Oh,
Aunt Audrey, would you mind if my father and I came back to visit you sometime? I'm sure he'd love to see you as well.
Oh, I think that would be nice. Oh, you say he's my brother.
Well, he's your stepbrother. He lives in Syracuse, and he remembers when you used to visit when he was young. He says that you were very beautiful.
Auntie Audrey, can I ask you a question?
Oh, yes, my dear. What is your question?
Are you going to have a birthday cake? I'm kind of hungry.
Indeed we are, with ice cream.
Happy birthday, Aunt Audrey.
Oh, happy birthday, Miss Munson.
Happy birthday.
For those of you who might like to stay, we're going to have a little talk back where we can provide some information. I'm going to introduce somebody who has sort of more intimate contact with Audrey Munson. Mr. Justin White is the Oswego County Historical Director, and he has some information that he'd like to provide for us, if possible, and we'll take any other questions. Justin, come on in. She loved to talk about Audrey to anybody who would be willing to listen. She was very proud of her daughter and her daughter's accomplishments. And she had a lot of souvenirs from her daughter, photographs, different kinds of things that she would share with my great aunt and my great uncle. So, fast forward to when I was about 7 or 8 years old, I used to visit my great aunt a lot. She and my grandmother are very close. And so, I loved to go to her house. I said, well, what about the
A lot of the
is buried in New Haven Cemetery. However, her mother, Kitty, is buried in St. Peter Cemetery in an unmarked grave. So hopefully someday she'll get a mark or two. But that's my connection to the story. And I have a few pictures if anybody's interested in looking at them. This is a still shot from the film Obscurity, 1916. I don't know if anybody heard that she was the first woman, first leading actress to appear nude in a feature film in 1915. And you can imagine that wasn't okay. But a lot of ministers and priests said they had to go to see the movie first. They had to tell you whether you could go or not. And this is Audrey, this is the Descending Night. This was one of the most popular statuary that she posed for in the San Francisco World Fair in 1915. And so I thought it was kind of very serendipitous that she went to the World Fair in 1901 as a young girl with that souvenir glass. And I bet you that she had no idea that she would become phenomenally successful because of the following World Fair in 1915, where she was the model for the majority of the artwork at that amazing Wonderland that they built. I think the cast was fantastic, by the way.
Thank you, Justin. Does anybody have any questions at all? Way in the back.
What happened with the murder, when the doctor murdered his wife? What happened with that?
He was sentenced to die in an electric chair. However, before his execution, he hung himself in jail.
Totally badmouthed Audrey and ruined her career.
Well, it was actually the press who did that. He never made any allusion at all that it was Audrey. He was so obsessed with her. But then it was the press that hounded her. And everybody just assumed that she was involved in some way with his wife's murder. And it was after that point that her life really just spiraled out of control. There was no work for her, no money, nothing. And mentally, she just became lost it.
Michael,
yes.
You, in the play, you suggest that there were no visitors during that, 60-year span?
So her mother would come to visit occasionally, Justin said. It was,
right,
it was,
yeah,
kind of a long ride.
Yeah. Audrey's mother was 66 when Audrey was institutionalized. So she was getting older, and she could only go by bus. And bus route going to Eisenberg was over 3 or 4 hours long, and that's the whole day just getting back. And as time went on, she was unable to even leave the city. It was a very sad separation between mother and daughter, very sad.
And then after that time, we're not sure if relatives just didn't know about her, where she was, or if they were ashamed and did not want to see her. But they did not visit her for years and years and years until Darlene Munson Bradley did come to the hospital. And they did get together for the last 4 or 5 years of her life. They did see her. Any other questions? Yes.
What institutions was she in when she passed away?
It was called St. Lawrence Hospital for the Insane.
In Augsburg?
Yes.
And she was there how long?
About 60 years.
Yeah, she was there for 64 years, a whole lifetime.
64. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm Justin. I just saw on the internet today that she did leave the Institute for a short period of time to go in a nursing home, but then she kept going next door to the bar.
I like to drink.
Girl needs a little slow gin.
She had a little bit of fun there.
She she apparently had to cross a four-lane highway to get to the lawsuit, and they didn't think that was very safe.
Yeah, she was moved to an assisted living facility because they realized that she should not be there. You know, Dr. Nupuf will attest that, you know, in today's world, she wouldn't have been employed for 64 years. It would have been an outpatient care.
That was going to be my question, what she was actually diagnosed with. And today, a pill would have probably helped her.
Right.
You know,
she probably had schizophrenia. And she could probably have been easily treated as an outpatient. Anybody? Yes, ma'am.
And was what she had, the poison or whatever, did that cause some of the mental breakdown?
Well, we think it was mercury.
Right.
And there is a possibility she may have had mercury poisoning from that. And that does contribute to mental illness and problems. So it is possible that may have contributed.
And was she only confined to a wheelchair because she was old, or had that caused, or you don't know that, had the poisoning caused other physical, she just ended up in the institution because she was kind of whacked up?
Correct. There was, I mean, there was more than one overdose. There was rumors that she tried to burn down the neighbor's barn. She tried to attack people with a pitchfork. Everybody knew she was crazy. She used to roller skate into town. With some kind of wagon or something she used to push.
She
was on roller skates and roller skating in and out of town. So
well, she had roller skated in the Vaudeville show. So she knew how to roller skate from doing drugs, well, you know, Vaudeville shows.
Yes, ma'am.
Was there ever a father involved in her life?
Yes, Edgar actually did see her on occasion. He lived in Syracuse, and he did see her occasionally. I don't know if he ever saw her in the mental institution or not.
No.
Never did.
No.
Shamed of her. Never wanted anything to do with her.
No, he felt that she had cried wolf too many times, and he didn't believe that she attempted suicide. He just thought that that was just safe. And then he found out that she really had attempted suicide.
This picture right here, is that a thing? I've seen that picture before. Is that a famous picture? The one with the thing in her hair?
It's not in the books. It may be somewhere.
Might be from a movie?
Mm-hmm. Yes, way in the back again.
So the scene where you guys do where she drank that stuff out of the bottle, was that a suicide attempt?
Yes.
And did she actually see... think she saw that man standing there, those people there? Is that
we kind of hinted that that was part of her mental illness. It was never written about that way, but it was kind of our interpretation.
Okay.
So,
has anybody found any of the records from the hospital in Ogdensburg?
I'm not aware of it.
The case file from?
Right.
No. No, they're not open to the public.
Because probably after a certain number of years, they, you know, the law allows people to access them, I think.
Yeah, I guess you can get a court order to open those if you have a good, you know, reason for doing so.
Interesting to think about. We have never done that.
Yeah, no. And Eileen, no, her niece is not interested in doing that. She just loved her aunt for being her aunt. Kind of interesting story with Arlene. She never questioned her about her past or her life as a model. She just wanted to reconnect with her and make her comfortable in her later years.
Just one more question.
Yes.
How was it that her family settled in this area of the state in the first place?
Why did the Munson family come here in the first place?
Oh, to Oswego County?
Yeah.
Edgar Munson, he was from the eastern part of the state. But his, he had an uncle that lived in Mexico. And he came to Mexico because of his uncle. His uncle worked in the Oswego County alms house in Mexico. He was the manager of the alms house. So that brought Edgar
buried with Mr. Munson in the New Haven Cemetery. She is buried under his headstone as Munson. So I don't know if she actually took his name, but she's, the headstone is Munson, and then there's Edgar, Cora, and Cora's sister, Vivian.
Audrey's sister.
Oh,
yeah.
No idea what her last
name is.
Audrey's sister, Vivian.
They couldn't handle
each other. Not sure.
she was totally against Audrey's way of life.
Yes, ma'am.
What was it that happened that you became so interested in Audrey?
So the interesting part of this is my cousin, Stephen Wolf, lives in New York City. And he was just about to publish a book on Central Park. And we were at a family get-together. We were riding in a car one day. And Stephen said he was writing a book about Central Park and had a chapter about Audrey Munson. And I looked at him, because I had just read a book by Mr. James Bone called Curse of Beauty about Audrey Munson. And I said, Stephen, did you know that Audrey Munson was living in New Haven? And I just read about her. So we kind of connected on that basis, that he knew about her. He didn't know anybody else ever knew about her. And one day I said to Bill Riley after reading the book, you know, this is a fascinating story. And he said, you should write a play about it. So it was Bill Riley suggested, you should write a play about it. And with Stephen's help, that's what we did.
Thank you
for doing Thank you very much. Good job, Laura.
Oh, thank you. As always, thank you.